I'm Ivan Cappiello from Mad Entertainment Animation Studio. Which one of you was here in 2013? Anyone?
Yeah.
Okay. And we were here too. It was our first Blender conference, and we presented some workflow for 3D CG animated series made in the 2D 3D hybrid style. And we have presented some lots of stuff like things like that, and how to do it in Blender, and lots of stuff about rigging, basically. We were coming from previous productions. Our studio is set in Naples, in Italy, and was built up around our first animated feature. This is called The Art of Happiness. You can find it on Blu-ray, I think. And I don't know which distribution has had outside Europe. So if you want, you can check it. And this is where we work. We have, in the last presentation in 2013, it was our first project entirely done in Blender. And time to time, in animation business, you start a series, you are going to production, you go pre-production, you do teasers, and then the production stops because of co-productors have to discuss about international rights and things like that. So in a while, the studio can test some new things when some spin-off works comes. And this is important for us because this is a quote from Woody Allen's movie, and it says, Virgil receives a cello as a gift, but he has no conception of the instrument he was blowing into it. This is how we felt initially with Blender, because we tried to replicate some sort of workflows we had in other softwares. And then we had the chance with some set of works to test what else we can do with less pressure without producers on our side. We tried it this kind of work is a bit difficult to explain because it was committed by a choir. It was a polyphonic choir. They say it means they sing all together with no instruments. They are the instruments. And they wanted to have live animations on their back when they were singing. We created these 10 images inspired to Saul Bass artworks. And we had the count that in the end it was in the total length of a short movie. each of these has the 5 minutes. It's an average of 3 minutes per each. So the problem was how to manage this because it was to be played on a single shot altogether. I'll let you see the movie. Can you please lower the lights? This is a reel of various animation. I cannot play it because 30 minutes is too long, so I condensed it in the best animations we've done. Thank you. Thank you. So it was probably we could have done in any 2D software, but it was kind of like to experiment to see what can we do with this. And technically, it was not very intriguing, but I will go through things you maybe already know. But this is how a simple set is done. For us, it's very important because the people you have seen in slides are not typical 3D animators. They're classical animators, illustrators, background artists. We have sort of mixing, a melting pot of talents. And it's important for us that each one of them is capable of doing something from the end, beginning to the end. And so even the backgrounds you see here, very schematics, but it's done from people that not always use a Blender for modeling or for creating artworks. Maybe are just animators. And it was very convenient because they also started rigging. I will come to rigging a bit after, but the interesting thing we have discovered, we could do in Blender, when I was saying use Blender as Blender, not as other softwares, there is this cool feature you probably already know, that you can link in an empty file your scenes from other Blend files. And this is very practical because that file, you can see I have named it editing. We used it for live editing the sequences because they were split into more short cuts because it was not possible for the animator to animate 3 minutes altogether in a practical time. So the cool thing is that when you import these, we link these scenes, you can use it in a video editing sequencer, and they will be acted just like film strips. You can edit them, you can put it together. This is a simple preview of how we did it. I think it's not particularly fancy, but we find it very useful, and as far as I know, this feature I have seen only in Blender. So you can see this is an empty file. There is one of, in this case, I think 10 or 12 separate scenes linked inside this empty file. And you can see it. It's DL, stands for link. And the practical thing is, if you see here, the timeline is switching accordingly to the sequence you are using. If you set the start and the end frame correctly in the single scenes, then you can have something like that. And this is live streaming from the video sequence editor that is editing scenes in this case. You can see there, you can switch the GL mode. And this was pretty new for us because which other software can do this? I don't know. But we tried to go a little further, and we also composited these frames through the compositor via the linked scene. So it is still composited in the same file, using the same scene as a reference for compositing. It's not very, when it's done composing, it's basic stuff, because otherwise the frame rate will go on 1-2 frames per second. But if you just want to test how it's done, it's good. And moreover, we used it to export all the sequence directly from here. And the animators could at any time open the animation sequence and see how their cut is matching with the other, and so on. I don't remember well. Ah, OK. This is the after. Can you please look at questa non te parla mai, bell'occhio oramai si mistera, che non mi fa più a ragionare, non nega ma sento più forte, si incula in soffile l'argente, ma se c'è che non mi è più sola, si resta sotto da guardare. Thank you. Thank you. As I was saying before, sometimes production stops, sometimes starts suddenly, you never know when. And in a while, we tested Blender furthermore for this teaser, that was for our upcoming movie. It should be in theaters next year. And this is our second feature film. At this moment, we were still doing pre-production and did this with crowdfunding campaign to show producers how the film would look. In a while we're doing all this stuff, it happened something big, because we are a small studio, and our budget for Art of Happiness was around €1 million, something like that. It's not big for a full feature animation. And they invited us in this wonderful show. Which one of you knows it? It's like the European Oscars. And we were at this beautiful show with Wim Wenders, is the president of the European Film Award. And we were in here against Jack and the Cuckoo Clock Art and Minuscule. These are big movie, European movies, big budget. And incredibly, we won. We won. It's the first Italian movie to win the European Film Award. I want to share this moment with you because for a little studio like ours, it's very important to have a software like Blender, because you can focus more on developing tools, but also you do not spend too much money in licenses. You can pay more artists. That is very important for low-budget movies. This was a great achievement, and give us the the strength to go further for the next movie. This is the prize we had in the studio. Okay, so coming to the actual presentation, this is, as you have seen from Caesar, our next feature film. I think you can recognize here Alessandro Rack was director of the Art of Happiness, who won the DFA. These are producers, this is me. This is Dario Sansone, he's also the author of the song you have heard in the teaser. And this is Marino Guarnieri, he's the fourth director with us three in this project. Yeah, fourth director. The story I can summarize as fast as I can is from the original novel that is not so international. It was written and written in Naples about in the 17th century. And the original story has some resemblance with the actual, from Disney or Perrault. And we centered the story about two separate times. One is the time of light, and is happening before Cinderella is actually Cinderella, and one is after, is a time of cinder, because there is a burning volcano that always make fall cinder on the city. This is the Cinderella's father, that is an inventor, and he has great projects for the city. This is her wife, supposed to be the wife, but she's going to become the stepmother of Cinderella. And this is her as a baby, as a child, and then when she became Cinderella, because the events you already know. Our charming prince has a bit set off aside from the story, because he acts like a private policeman for the father of Cinderella and knows her from the beginning. And when the father of Cinderella is killed, he can do for meet again Cinderella and save her. And this is our bad guy, is called The King, and he's a singer, in the time he became a mob boss, and he was together with the stepmother responsible for the killing of Mia's father. These are six sisters. They are six because in the original novel they are six, and the stepmother already has them from previous marriage. Okay, this is some pictures of actual frame of the movie. And I think I can show you 1 minute of the movie. This actual movie.
Perché quando mi vira sangri fa come gatta poi ne godaccio fa a me io te la voglio ben assai e tu non pensi a me
calma, calma questa non è mica la mia serata no, ad ancora arrivare a film che mi fa fissi conosco Don Vittorio da quando sono bambino, non teneva manco 18 anni e già lo chiamavano scienziato, sangue nobile, una famiglia importante, una famiglia di costruttori, di inventori, e lui non è da meno, tiene dei progetti un poco strampalati come questa nave, la nave dei fantasmi, ma come dice Angelica è un genio, grande armatore, ricco, intelligente, ottimista, insomma, ha solo sbagliate città.
Thank you. Thank you. So this is coming to theaters next year. We are about finishing it, and it was entirely done in Blender, except for the compositing, because we had some problems with compositor not for the compositor itself, that it tends to be slow in some cases, but because not every animator we can teach how to composite, because as I said before, each of us do everything in the production, so we try to keep the things together. This is I want to show you, maybe I'll skip it if I have no time, but this is how we did the basic backgrounds. This time it's all 3D, and we don't use textures, we use vertex color to have this flat shading. It tends to be less memory intensive, and you can see as much as you want how it will look in the final frame. I don't think I have time to show everything, but I want to show there is a scene in the movie where this is like an hologram aquarium. So you can see fish that are going to swim all around the world, and I waiting that to happen here for some. Okay, this is. This background elements was done again with something we asked ourselves, how we do this in Blender? Let's try. And the thing is, we can link one character, one rigged character, that is like one fish inside Blender. You will see in a few seconds. Each fish, we have five, six. Singular fish for each group, and we just duplicate it animated as is. It works. I never asked myself if it was possible, but it was possible, and we did this like randomizing and offsetting the group itself with the soft selection tools. And it worked for us. We can also reparent it to some empty. and do all kind of stuff. I don't think I have time to go through all this. Let's see. Yeah, maybe I can. But I want to skip over. If you want, you can contact me after, and we can see some more. Okay, I think the slide is pretty clear what we did. Okay, this is how we export for compositing. It's very, very basic. We have the color path that is just vertex color. We have a shade path, sometimes a Z path that is not listed here, and a freestyle line path. That's all. And then the background artist receives this shading in their paint app, and they stuck the layers all together, and they paint over it. So they had the control on how the elements are stacked, and then with a simple masking for ground background, and then it's composited with characters to have the final frame that I should see here. That's the final frame from the movie. So, how many people know what is Rigify or ever used it? Oh, lots of people. Okay. Why we choose Rigify? For starting, I have to say we have, till now, and it's going to raise a bit, 110 characters in the movie. There's a marriage, there's an audience at the show. It's very, very complicated to rig all these characters together. So, we used for all the project Rigify, and when we were here in 2013, Nathan Wegdal updated this wonderful piece of software where it was like in Pichipo in Israel, I think. And they presented it here, and we were doing lots of complicated stuff, and we said to each other, why don't we try the included one? So the benefits of Rigify is that if you don't know, maybe you already know, it's a modular rig system. It means that each part of the rig is made by itself. You can do an arm, a leg, a spine, and so on. And in our pipeline, this rig is shared through characters. It means you will see maybe later that you can paste animation on which character you want, because the controls are always have the same name, the same positions, and so on. The meta rigs can be updated and regenerated, so you can add two arms or one face more if you want, and you will not lose your previous control. How it works, I will explain for the one who you are not using it like this, is there is a custom attribute on each bone chain, and every bone chain or sample or examples has a required number of bones to work. And then when you assemble it together, you can have new metrics. This is actually used in the movie. I will show you in a while. And these are the kind of types you can use. This was not working. We fixed it. I'll come to it later. And then all the mechanics are done for you with all tweak bones and so on. It's not so difficult to use, but it's not very well documented. So you have to have a bit of practice to use it. This is how we use it in the movie for our cat scenes. I cannot show you the audio because the film is not yet in theaters. But you can see there are lots of cats. They count on the 110 characters. Okay. So we did some testing and it seems to work. Ok. I'm teasing a bit more of the movie. Hope I have no problems. So, another kind of metrics we had to do is birds. Again, you create metric, bam, it works. This is the actual bird we used, and this is a scene with the bird. Here he's actually singing. Oh, and even the fish are made by Rigify. This was made by animators, directly from animators. They put in a spine, a tail, and it creates for us, bam, the rig. Oh, even strange animals. This is for Venice Film Festival. Okay, so our work on Rigify is divided in two parts. The first part is fix existing code. And the PO, as I was mentioning, is what was not working, was there, but was not finished, as the code was a tiny fix. We did it. There was some, this was a big error. I don't know why, which is the reason why it was there. There was floating points, position errors on the superface bones that means controls were offsetting and rotating. I don't know why it was a quick fix. We did it. Rotation button tweaks. Even this for me is strange coming from other softwares, because in Blender there is quaternion neural rotations, but the Rigify rig is set always on quaternion, even on things that should spin on the one axis, and this gives you the some way of messing it, because you can have rotation on other axis. It's a fix. You won't see it, but it's working right now. And tail option on super torso. This was working and not depends on the case. We had a fix, and now we can add this for cats, fish, birds, and so on. About the epithetic Anton, I have two videos here. IKFK snapping was missing on the Pitchy Poi version of Rig, and this is how it's working now. This is all auto-created from the Rigify, from the Metaic. Okay, it simply just works. No fancy stuff. We just fixed the missing code going starting from Rigify original code by Nathan Vector. Then IK limb isolation mods. That was requested for us by some other guy, and effectively we used it in production. So we did implement in Rigify itself. It works like that. Basically, when in IK mode, the limbs tend to stay on where the root is. And you can see it here. You can pause it, and then when you move the torso, the hands stay like that. It's not very practical when you're using, yes, you can use FK, but in some cases, switching is not practical for animator. And in this way, using this, enabling this following parent, you can decide which pony is to follow the root or the direct parent. The other is, if you set IK follow on zero, then the end is free, will not follow the root anymore, and you can use your own constraints to do things like that. It's very handy if you're in production, you don't want to do lots of switching. This is already committed in 278. Okay. Bone groups and colors, I will not explain too much. The controls are created basically just with the black color. We added some feature that classifies the bone groups It creates bone groups that's very handy for like fingers, hands, face. You can select via bone groups menu. And moreover, it adds colors so you can customize them after. This is not yet in master. And then character utilities, I have no slides for it, but basically you can regenerate the rig. If you update some feature, you have a meta rig and a rig, you can press a button and update the rig from the meta rig. One of our character utilities do some stuff under Duke is basically the rig has an ID number to be recognized and run the UI in Python in the viewport. And so when you duplicate this character, the rig ID is not changed. We have an utility that lets you change the name of the rig and the rig ID for that, and also update only the bones that you are changing, not all the rig. Maybe you just want to fix the face. You don't want to recreate custom properties and so on, and it is going to work like that. This is still not in master, will be after we finish the movie. Oh, bending bones. Yes, bending bones, hot topic. And I don't know if everybody knows, but Rigify in this PHP version already use bending bones for limbs especially. You can see this in action. And it's all created by the Rigify itself without having to touch anything. So it's working. And for cartoon animation, it's very handy because if you see our 2013 presentation, we are doing this through our scripting. But since it's already implemented in Rigify, that wasn't me. What else can I show you? OK. This is the main feature we originally switched to Blender, because we had to write this add-on. We want to do animation for background situations. We have, I repeat, 110 characters. You cannot make 8 or 10 animators animate clapping people, working people for all day long, for one month after another, for 18 months. So we had to develop some kind of low-cost motion capture to work with it. The basic is you can import and use the meta rig, export, import the meta rig to store the BVH animation. And then you can constrain the Rigify rig to the meta rig, because they are the same thing. They have bones in the same positions. But the meta rig is very, very simplified. And the cool thing is we don't want motion capture and stopping. We want the animator to interact with this. And so we built this interface that lets the animator choose which pose has to be kept, not keeping all together. And then when you're ready, you say, this I want, this I want, this I want, this one I want, then you can disable the constraints and see which are the poses you are keeping and if it's enough for you to refine. And you can add any pose you want at any time. And animators really love this because they have some kind of layout done and they can tweak it. Obviously, this is what imports the BVH, because the motion capture takes 30 frames per second. And we are animating at 12 because we want this classic look. And this is how you can keep, if you want, all the animation. You take it all and then the animator clean up the standard way. Or you can specify a step for extraction, like here, one frame, it means each frame. Three, it means one on three. Four, and you can customize it. This is the animation extracted without refinement. Obviously, we are not using this for animation. We are using this for additional animation. And anyway, you always have to animate hands and face by hand, and that's are the most important parts in animation. That part is done with the pose library manager. You have hands in various positions, you can just click it and use it also for a facial feature. This is a comparison of what the extraction did in this case with no refinement. I think it's also, this is Alessandro Arc playing a singer. As you can see here, this is a standard extraction. There's no manual keyframing here, just to test how accurately it will take. Usually we use to take one frame on three, because we don't need much more than that. This is another cool feature from Oganima. We use it for work cycles, because animator tends to lose a lot of time in customizing lots in the work cycles. So we had, since our movie is basically realistic in the field, we decided to give some try to motion capture to have this for the animators. And you can see different characters and different works done like in 12, 30 minutes. This is a bit more on how many poses do you need to make a work cycle in Mocanim. It's like you will see here, all the poses the animator choose, and then what you will see. Okay, just 6 more keyframes here. And this is how it looks. And after the refinement and some cloth animation, it's all made by bones through Rigify. This is how it looks. And here I show you what I mean with the character rigs are intercommunicating. You can paste it, the animation from one character to another, because the character shares the same controls and rig. The bones that are added are not considered. If he has not here the dress, it will not be considered, but the controls that are similar are used. And again, you can also replicate the character after you did it to these wife storms. She don't want to stay in. Okay. Olivier is rushing me for okay. No, it's almost over. Yeah, we are still testing it a bit further in production, and it will work for now only with the PitchBoy version of Rigify. Next steps. Okay, we have something on the code sides and something on the side and UI. On the code, there is the needing of a general cleanup, because there are lots of typos, like stretch is written like stretch in the controls. We fixed it just as displaying, but the operator underneath is still called like that. It should be fixed. There is not PayPay compliant. Then we need a unified MetaRigs and RigSample systems, because now we have basic version, PitchBoy version. There are lots of samples. It's not very handy to use if you don't know where to pick all the features. And a new method for parenting and constraining, because now the MetaRig is the key for doing all this, and all the parenting is done by the MetaRig. If you parent one bone to another, it knows if this is a chain or a basic parenting. And, okay, last. We want to replace the MetaRig system with a widget system. So you can place the hand and the fingers like just only the widgets, or the shoulder or the face moving this widget and not the single bones together. That tends to be not very user-friendly when you have to calculate bone rolls and so on. Integrate interactive selection and key inset tools. I have seen a presentation yesterday, I think it's called Julian Drurore, hey, that is already doing some things like that. Maybe we keep in contact and trying to implement this, because key insights are really required to Rigify to work efficiently. Because you may want to select all the fingers in one time and so on. Julian already has some cool stuff. Maybe we can integrate this. Also, with the Rigi samples UI, Rigi samples are now stored in just a list. And there's also a list that contemplates basic copy, super copy, super torso turbo, and super face wonder things. I would like to unify these and have a more compact list and more handy selections to maybe you want an arm, bump, select the arm icon, and so on. And then the character mesh collection. This is, could be very handy for closing up, wrapping up the add-on, because right now, the only way you have to update a character is you have the metric, and then you have the rig itself. And when they are all in the same file, you can update it. But the thing that's going on is that Rigify keeps the armature object itself, deletes all the bones inside, and refill it. That's the way to keep the deformers on. But if we could have a mesh collection to store this data, that will be very, very handy. OK, the discussion is still in progress, is here. We have made a proposal to make this change. Some are already master. Some may come or not. We can discuss with you what else we could do. If you want to have any questions, we can talk outside later. You can talk to me or to Lucio Rossi is here. He is the coder of this work. Thank you.